gentlemen, happy Sunday to everyone, and welcome to an all-new edition of War a Week Radio. Guys, this would not be a Sunday night without the counsel of our good friend James Gogue. Before we introduce our featured guest of the evening, we do have to remind everyone that this show is brought to you by FightSaga.com. Guys, for all the latest watching news, please go visit FightSaga.com. But guys, I've been waiting all day to pick the maestro James Gogue's brain on the huge Canelo victory over Callum Smith, winning the Ring Magazine, ring-recognized 168-pound crown. So, guys, without further ado, let's welcome five-decade fight trainer, the one and only Mr. James Gogue. James, how the heck are you, brother?
Hey, Joe, I'm doing good. To me, that was the best show of the whole year. You know, this dismal year in boxing, you know, with no crowds, lack of excitement, sentiment level low. This was, you know, it brought a big spark to boxing because just the way the show was, the production of the show, the fireworks, the big crowd that was there. Eddie actually did a great job of, putting this show together. Of course, you got the biggest draw in boxing on this side of the world, and everybody was really, curious or excited to see him return.
Oh, absolutely. That was one of the questions that I was going to ask you a little bit later on in the show, but let's get to that now that you just brought it up. Obviously, Eddie Hearn was kind of making his official application in trying to lure, Canelo and keep him with Matchroom Sport as well as keep him on the network DAZN. And according to what Eddie Hearn and both Canelo stated after the show, they were both extremely pleased. Canelo was especially pleased, like you stated, because of the presentation. He loved the ring walk. But Gogi, what did you think of that mishap with the virtual Michael Buffer, and then having David Diamante actually do the ring announcements at the same time?
Oh, God. And you know what? Want to hear something funny? The night, the fight before, I think it was with Mark Castro, they introduced the referee as John Shorley, and it was my friend Mark Calloy.
Mark Calloy, yeah.
When they announced the referee in the ring, John Shorley and Mark Calloy.
Oh, jeez.
I looked at his eyes like, what the F are they? What the hell are they doing?
Yeah, I like David Diamante. I like everyone in the business, who has the balls to get up on stage and to do the ring announcing, because I do it as well. But, yeah, I don't know if David Diamante is ready for that level quite yet. He's not Jimmy Lennon Jr. He's not Michael Buffer. He did a fine job yesterday, but, yeah, he had a couple of screw-ups.
Yeah.
I just don't think he – I mean, I like Lupe Contreras, too. I think all three of those guys are better, and they're more fit to be hosting and being the ring announcer for a big event like that. Other than that, Gogi, how would you grade Matchroom Sport's job as event coordinator of last night's big, big event? And they had a max capacity for the seating. I think it was like 11,460, something like that is the number that they gave me. But it was a sellout, though. What did you think? How would you grade Matchroom Sports?
Oh, they did an excellent job. I mean, just the presentation, Joe, the fireworks, like you said, the ring walk.
Beautiful, wasn't it?
Overall, Joe, all around, they did an excellent job. I cringe at the people calling fights nowadays. These young guys calling fights, man. They're not seasoned enough. Like the announcers in the old days who really knew boxing compared to these guys. You know what I'm talking about.
I don't even want to mention Chris Mannix, brother. Like, Sergio Mora's not bad. Brian Kenny is a big mouth. I don't like him when he argues with fighters. Like, he's arguing. He's just a plebeian, and he's arguing with guys who've actually been in the ring. But Chris Mannix, yeah, that guy kind of gets on my nerves, Gogi.
Well, there's a lot of guys. I mean, you see all these networks, these fighters trying to be announcers. I fucking crack up. You know, these guys are too seasoned and green to know how to call a fight. They think they understand boxing, but, you know, in reality, you know what I mean? It's a different when you got to call it, you know, live and, you know, and bring up new, insights and calling the flow of the fight correctly for example, the fighters, what adjustments the fighters need to make in the fights and stuff like that, or, you know, what the fighters are doing wrong. And, you know, it just takes, you know, I've been doing this a while, so I can see this stuff real fast and everything. And some of these guys, Andre Ward's good. I give him credit. Andre Ward is very, very prepared when he goes into a broadcast. He speaks well. He's very, you know, very charismatic. You know, he's very eloquent.
Indeed.
And he's very knowledgeable, okay? Andre Ward, yeah, he's, to me, Raul Marquez, you know, one of my students I trained when he was younger, he's become very good and evolved into calling a fight, you know, with a lot of intelligence perspective. But most of them, God, like, oh, fuck it. Abner Morris, oh, God.
Oh, geez, he's dreadful, brother.
Oh, geez.
Oh,
and,
gosh. I really like Abner also as a person. So it's hard to listen to.
Yeah, he just ain't got no business being behind a mic. He has no skills. He has no boxing IQ. Okay? You know, Sean Porter's decent. He just needs to brush up on, more of a boxing.
On his wardrobe?
Well, you know, the wardrobe, Sean, but, you know, he's still got to brush up on his boxing IQ on overall. The many of the little nuances of the game, he never brings up when a fight, you know, plays out, stuff like that. Marquez, Raul does it, because I've been working on Raul Marquez when he first started for, I don't know, 20 years plus, and I used to tell him, the strengths and weaknesses of both fighters and, the adjustments they got to make, the weaknesses they have, so when he calls a fight, he sees it, and, he can, plus he's done this so many times, and Raul, boy, he's done every network in boxing from, NBC, from Showtime to HBO Latino, you name it. He's done every Showbox, everything. You name it, pay-per-view. He's done so many broadcasts over the, last 20 years. So, he's real comfortable. He's got a good flow. He brings up a lot of, intelligent, analysis when he does a sport. The other guys like Sean Porter's green. I'm telling you that right now. What's the name's green? Abner Morris. Tim Bradley does a good job. You know, when he ain't yelling, you're yelling your ears off on the mic. Okay, he does a good job, and he's become better. Because when he was on remember that TV show Top Rank had, and they canceled when Tim Bradley first started. What was the name of it? What was that network?
No, Spike was PBC. It was True TV.
Yeah, remember when he did that? He was terrible, but over the years...
Oh, he was terrible. He's gotten a lot better.
Oh, he really cultivated his crap.
Yeah, indeed. I think we've all been spoiled, though, Gogi. Because, you know, if you think of back in the day, Jim Lampley, Larry Merchant, they were the benchmark. But, you know, I also love, though, Steve Albert and Bobby Chaz at Showtime. Weren't
they
awesome?
Were good.
I loved it.
Good.
And I also love the announcing team for the old USA Network Tuesday Night Fights.
Well, to me, Gil Clancy was real good at what he did. Howard Cosell.
Yeah.
Okay,
they were the best. Yep,
yeah.
They were the best.
You know, that's what I'm used
like,
to. Now
no
I got to
one...
listen to these guys. Yeah, with their unintelligent opinions, or their lack of insight, But
you
anyway.
Know what? Everyone who gets into this business, because I do announcing also, and I do ring announcing as well. I do commentary, but that's how I actually got started was looking at the greats, looking at Howard Cosell, looking at guys like Gil Clancy, looking at guys like Jim Lampley, listen to guys like Steve Albert call the action. You know, that's what everyone should – it should be mandatory. If you're going to do this job, listen to how they announce the fights. And then if you want to provide color commentary, listen to Emmanuel Stewart do not listen to George Foreman.
Manuel was excellent. Manuel Stewart, he was sharp behind the mic. Right now, Joe Goosen does a real good job because, you know, he's a veteran. He's been doing this, you know, he was doing this before a lot of them guys were born. So he, you know, Joe.
He and Lennox do a great job, I think, together.
Well, Joe really carries him, though, man, because Joe, you know what does he have? Over 40 years being in the game, working with so many different types of different levels of fighters, world champions, being in big fights and all that. I've known Joe, I don't know, since 85, and his knowledge of the game is, you know, it's spot on. And like I said, you know, he always brings intelligent insight. For example, Joe, let me give you an example. None of these fucking announcers, okay? Joe Goosen, when he announces a fight, when two guys get in the pocket, first thing they do is, you know, tie each other up. Joe goes, you know, these guys right here, see what they're missing? There's a lot of good opportunities when you slip inside, in the pocket to get some work in, and these guys are not doing it. He's the only guy that talks about inside fighting. No, all them other guys I've listened to, none of them stress it, especially them announcers from the UK. Oh, Jesus, they're clueless on inside fighting. But Joe, you know, it's stuff like that, the little insights, the little nuances of the game that Joe brings to the national audience that's listening, you know, compared to all the other bullshit you hear from these other guys.
Nonetheless, I tell you what, let's start talking about the fight because, yeah, the event was tremendous. And obviously,
excellent.
Eddie Hearn was auditioning to try and become, the most preferred promoter. I guess the promoter of choice by Canelo Alvarez and Eddie Reynoso. And, last night, I think for the time being, and when you consider the competition at 168 pounds currently, that's currently working with DAZN, I think it's safe to say that Canelo for the next year, more than likely, is going to be working with Eddie Hearn, Matchroom Sport, and DAZN. And so you may have been right, Gogi. You stated this several weeks ago that, I think Canelo just didn't have a problem with DAZN. He just wanted to stop working with Oscar De La Hoya. And once again, this happens sometimes, guys. No, this shouldn't have been personal. Oscar has obviously taken this personally. Canelo took it personally. But this happens. And, you know, credit goes to Golden Boy Promotions as to how they cultivated the star of Canelo Alvarez with our mentor, your very dear friend, the late, great Mr. Don Chargan, as well as Eric Gomez, Roberto Diaz,
Richard Schaefer. Let's give credit to where it's due. Joe, let's give credit to where it's due. Canelo was a star before he got here, okay? He was developed by a guy named Gilberto Mendoza, Hall of Famer Gilberto Mendoza, Don Chargan's buddy. That was his manager. Mm-hmm. He's the one that got him hot in Mexico. He's the one that made him a ticket seller over there in Guadalajara.
He was a reality TV star already before he signed with Golden Boy.
He was a TV star with Televisa because, Mendoza had a lot of connections with Televisa, and he always got him on TV, on Televisa to get him hot because Televisa is the number one network here in Mexico, the biggest TV network, and he was constantly getting them on every building that Canelo brand over here in Mexico. So when he came here to the States, he was already a star. Everybody knew who he was. The Mexicans knew who he was. The Mexicans in the States knew who he was when he came over here. So, Golden Boy just took, they did a good job and they took over what they did, but to start from scratch and to build them to the star, that's the hard part. It's easy, like Joe. Well, I take guys, most of my guys, I've been taking from scratch and, they don't understand. I build them up from scratch, from the ground up, teaching them the fundamentals of the game, okay? That's, I could do that because I've been in this business a long time. But when I get guys, like when I was in Colombia, who were established veterans, they're easy to train. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
It's easy, or you see a lot of these guys now, like that young kid trainer. What's his name from England? Ben Davidson, I think that's his name. Yeah.
Ben Davidson, yeah.
Yeah, he sounds great in this and that, but shit, look at all the fighters. Josh Taylor, Tyson Fury, Billy Joe Sanders. Them guys can fight. Let me see him take guys from scratch and build them up. Then we'll find out what kind of fucking coach he is, okay? Right now, he's getting guys. It's so easy to train guys. when you got guys that can fight, okay? But when you got a guy that doesn't know much or that's raw and green and you're trying to build him up from scratch, well, then you got to earn your work. Then you start earning your money as being a coach. And that's the same thing with the fighter. You know, they already had it. They brought him from Mexico already a star. So they all, you know, it was for them to fuck it up, okay? If they did something, if they did something wrong, you know what I mean? He was already a star. And that's, you know, so you got to, you know, you got to give the credit to where it's due, and it started with Mendoza, who passed away.
Well, you know, we'll get back to this, and my point I was making, though, yeah, Golden Boy's in the rear view, and I think as long as Eddie Hearn continues to put on shows like this, create matchups like this, and as long as DAZN is willing to pay for him, yeah, I think Canelo's going to be in good hands with Matchroom Sport in terms of expanding his global brand. Because Matchroom Sport, as well as DAZN, they're featured in over 200 different countries. So, yeah, this may be the right choice. Because you know this, Gogi. Every promotional group has been lobbying and petitioning and pitching Canelo Alvarez, right? They've been trying to get him. And I think Eddie Hearn just got the job last night, which was my point. But let's go back to the fight.
Well, Joe,
obviously, the
Joe, it's a one-fight deal now. If PBC comes up with some good money to fight Charlo or any of them guys on pay-per-view where he can make a lot more, I guarantee you he's going to go back. You know, that's
of course.
That's what
of
he
course. Of course.
That's what he wanted, his freedom, Joe. To get the best deal out there fight by fight, just like Sugar Ray Leonard did back in the days.
Yeah, of course, of course. But when you look at the landscape of where Canelo wants to be, when you heard him in the press conference, he's happy being at 168 pounds, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. But let's get to the fight. Obviously, Canelo Alvarez, boy, he showed without a doubt that he is the pound-for-pound best fighter in boxing. Basically, pitching a virtual shutout against the ring-recognized former super middleweight champion, Mr. Callum Smith, picking up the Super WBA title, as well as the WBC and Ring Magazine Championship. Gogi, first of all, how many rounds did you score for Callum Smith when you were watching the fight?
Two the most, 2 to 3. Canelo totally dominated the fight. You know, he, from round one on, he was in complete control.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, in my opinion, Gogi, and we'll go into everything that Canelo did just effectively. But in my opinion, I think this may have been his finest performance in the ring.
Yeah.
Against a guy who was, before the John Ryder fight, was considered a top 10 pound-for-pound guy. Right? So how did Alvarez, what did he do to take away, seemingly, all of Callum Smith's primary weapons in the ring? Because it looked like he put him in checkmate, I guess, as early as round 3 or 4.
Well, I thought he was checkmate after the first round, Joe. Okay, Joe, number one, you can see the difference in height, length, and all that. So Canelo had to get closer. He had to close that distance intelligently. I call that intelligent pressure, okay? What are the fundamentals that starts with your footwork? Being able to, you know, get close to the guy, sliding in, you know, sliding out of range, sliding in, sliding out of range. You know, Lomachenko, okay, he's a good example, okay? It starts with good footwork. Number two, it starts with good, you know, a good head and upper body movement, good reflex to slip the punches. Because when you're walking into a guy's kill zone, oh, he's going to be firing some shots at you, you know, the right hands, the uppercuts, the hooks, the jabs, whatever. You got to be able to defend yourself with that. And Canelo's, you know, his head and upper body movement, because he's got great eyes, great reflexes, and great, you know, upper body agility, you know, to move his body in different directions, you know, just subtly, just to make you miss. Oh, it's fabulous. Another thing you got to have to apply intelligent pressure is you got to have a good, solid jab, okay? Because Canelo, he knows his distance. He knows, okay, when he gets in range, okay, I can hit him with a jab now, okay? Because, he's been around. He's a veteran. He has a good sense on how far he's got to be away from his opponent for his jab to land. And, of course, you know, his real high guard tight defense. You know, he had his hands up real nice and tight where, you know, he was blocking a lot of the punches. But that's the key, Joe, because that aggressive, that intelligent, aggressive pressure fighting he was doing, without good defense, he would have been looking like Jaime Manguia too, okay, taking a lot of punishment walking in, all right, or Alfredo Angulo, okay, the Mexican human punching bag. But because Canelo's not like that, he's like a young Julio Cesar Chavez in his prime, you know, who knew how to pressure you with great, tactical, intelligent pressure skills, head movement, good jab. He said footwork. He knew how to cut out the ring. Canelo, well, beautifully, how he cut out the ring. Every time Callum Smith tried to slide right or left, he would slide along with him, laterally, like a middle linebacker going sideline to sideline, trying to stop the run. And that's what Canelo did, boy. That was the key, Joe. But, he's so physically strong. You know what I mean? That's what makes it. That's another thing that makes his tactics so effective. It's his physical strength. You can't hurt him. You can't deter him. You can't push him back. You know what I mean? He's got good leverage. When he gets inside, he has a low center of gravity where it's hard to push him back. Okay, he has a good strong base. His legs, and his hips. I mean, he's got a good his legs is a good core. You know, his legs, his hips, and his midsection and everything. Where he's nice and firm. You know, he's planted in there where, you just can't push the guy around and everything. He's solid as a rock, Joe. I've been in the gym with him. I had guys spar him when he got ready for when he fought Mayweather. So I seen he's like a little bull, a little tank and everything. You know what I mean? And he hits extremely fucking hard. Oh, geez. Joe, that was the key. His intelligent pressure and, what's the name? We talked about it last week on the show. What I wanted to see was what happened when Canelo got inside. If Callum Smith had anything to deter him, to get his attention, to put some fear in him, and he didn't. Right off the bat, I seen that. I'm like, oh, God. Checkmate.
No. Yeah, and you just saw one round after another where just Canelo just, I was really impressed, though, with he and Eddie Reynoso's plan for really stealing Callum Smith's best weapon, and that was the sneaky check left hook that he customarily hurts every single opponent he's ever faced leading up to this. And you told me about this, and I hadn't seen something like this in a very long time. Boy, he just slammed that left arm of Callum Smith to the point where doctors thought that maybe he detached his tricep or bicep. And you saw it just hanging off of his arm to the point where Joe Gallagher in the 11th or 12th round was getting ready to stop it. Talk about that tactic.
Oh, George Benn taught me that a long time ago. He told me, the guy's hard to hit. Hit his arms, hit his shoulders. Hit him, anywhere. And it's going to deaden his arms. It's just like another thing, another trick George taught me was hit a guy in his hips. When you're on the inside, hit him on his hips, and that deadens the legs. And when you hit a guy right on the hips, and his legs give out, you can't move as effectively, And it's the same thing, the principle, hit it. Canelo, he was digging them punch, he was digging that little sweeping right hook to, his left arm and everything. When he was throwing them body shots, he was digging them arm shots too, and pretty much, left the big old swollen, side of his left arm.
That was disgusting, Gogi.
Yeah, where he couldn't, I don't know if he could, he was still using it, but it takes a lot of steam off that out of your left arm when you're trying to use your jab or throw your left hooks or your left uppercuts or whatever.
Yeah, well, from what Callum Smith stated post-fight, now obviously he went to the hospital and he went to go get checked out and he didn't attend the final post-fight press conference, but he did state after the fight, I saw an interview with him, and he stated that he wanted to throw the left hook several times and he couldn't, he could stick it out to maybe use it as a jab straight out in front of him, but he couldn't sweep it any longer because of that horrific injury bulging out of his left arm.
Yeah,
they were successful in, well, just negating Callum Smith's best weapon. And without that, yeah, he was pretty much a sitting duck the entire night. When you look at punch stats, Gogi, Alvarez connected, with a 214 total punches with 494 attempts at an amazing 43.3% connect rate, right? And Callum Smith threw 539 punches but only landed 99 of them at an abysmal 18%. But once again, this is the majesty of Canelo Alvarez at this point. Not only is he an offensive juggernaut and he punches, he's explosive combining speed with power, but you can't hit this guy. His reflexes, his upper body and head movement, his intelligence, and now when you couple in his improved footwork, Gogi, I think we're seeing a future Hall of Famer in his prime at 168 pounds. What are your thoughts on him fighting at 168? Are we seeing him now in his fighting prime?
He's fighting the best of his whole career. Look, Joe, this is more of his natural weight. When he fought 160, 154, he really had to suck, you know, he really had to suffer a lot, sacrifice a lot just to make those make that weight. And it drained a lot of his, energy out of him. And it affected his stamina, you know, in the fight. You know, you can see him get tired in the fight, break down in a fight and everything. You know, because what happens, fight fans listening out there, you know, when you have to, when you really have to take a lot of weight off, especially when you're preparing for a fight, you might make the weight, but the next day when you fight, you know, you're not going to be 100% because that take, you know, that takes a lot of, your stamina away, when you, especially when you start fighting in them grueling fights like he's been in, when you got to go the rounds. But if you're in training camp and, you ain't got to really suffer to take that damn weight off, you know what I mean? And you make weight easily, preferably have a good meal the day of the weigh-in. Oh, yeah, you're going to be strong as a bull. Because, like I said, Joe, it's more natural for your body. It's more healthy for your body doing that. And yesterday, Canelo was strong as a bull. And you can see he didn't have no stamina issues like he's had in past fights. And he was, 12 good rounds. He was working hard every round.
Yeah, indeed. He was. This is the most complete version of Canelo Alvarez that I've ever seen. And, yeah, this, I think it's his finest performance as a professional. And, yeah, so after the fight, Gogi, well, let's stay on the fight for a second. In my opinion, Gogi, when you look at, like, when you started to see things completely unravel for Callum Smith, I think you could have made an argument. Now, there wasn't a knockdown, obviously, but I think you could have made an argument in rounds 9 and 10 for being 10-8 rounds. Isn't that what you were thinking? I mean, they were, I mean, he basically beat him up from pillar to post, and it was shocking.
Yeah. he pretty much dominated him and everything. Like I said, after the first round, when I seen Joe, he didn't have what it took to, you know, get Canelo's attention, to instill some fear in him, pretty much Canelo was going to be the bully in the fight and, you know, keep marching forward, straight ahead. Now, you see when he fought Golovkin, he didn't do that because Golovkin had that dominant jab popping in his face, okay? You know, breaking his face up slowly, okay? So that's the difference between, remember I told you Callum Smith had a good jab, but it wasn't a dominant jab, you know, to get Canelo's attention, like Floyd Mayweather or Gennady Golovkin. And that's why you saw the fight a lot more competitive.
Indeed. Indeed. And, yeah, boy, without that left hand, yeah, Callum Smith was a sitting duck. So, yeah, your winner. And, once again, scorecards read 119-109 twice and 117-111, the closest one being 9-3. In my opinion, Gogi, yeah, I only scored, I I mean, if I'm being nice, I can maybe give him two rounds. But after maybe the second round, yeah, I don't think you could have given Smith a round after that. It was just all Canelo Alvarez from there. So post-fight, and we'll talk about the different fighters who were at the event. But post-fight, Canelo was asked, well, someone from the media asked him, are you interested in a fight with Errol Spence and working with PBC? And Canelo Alvarez stated, you know what? No, I'm not interested in – I have respect for Errol Spence, and that's a great fight, but that isn't parallel with my goals at this time. I want to clean out 168. So right now I'm focused on getting all the belts at 168 pounds. That told me right there that – and obviously Al Haymon, Errol Spence Jr., they were kind of pitching him last night – with a huge money matchup. And obviously, Canelo versus Errol Spence Jr., Gogi, would be a bigger money fight than one against Billy Joe Saunders. But at this time, that told me everything. Canelo Alvarez is comfortable fighting at 68. He feels like he's his strongest right now. He feels like this is the best division for him. And right now, most of the 68-pounders that he's interested in, the title holders, are currently fighting for DAZN, Billy Joe Saunders. And then they're talking about, Eddie Hearn mentioned this, a third fight with Gennady Golovkin in September of 2021. So that's the reason why I stated that in the beginning of the show. But let's go to Errol Spence Jr., Gogi. What were your thoughts? And honestly, I have respect for every fighter, but to be honest with you, Gogi, I lost a ton of respect for Spence last night with what he stated. When he was interviewed by the guys from DAZN, he stated this, you know what, I think it's a great fight, me and Canelo, especially at 160 pounds. It would be an all-out war, have it at AT&T Stadium in Dallas with 100,000-plus fans. I'm a guy that sucks down to get to 147 pounds. I want to be the undisputed champion at welterweight, but if there's a great fight at 60, I could definitely move up to 160 pounds and fight him easily. And, yeah, Canelo basically stated this. I saw him. I'm very grateful that he was there. But the reality is that we have other goals right now with the 168-pound titles, end quote. And basically Spence stated that he's not interested in a fight with Terrence Crawford unless he's willing to take 30% of the purse. He said the cut should be 70-30, which means if you're translating this and in the business of boxing, you understand he's pricing himself out of that fight. Either that, or Haymon is blowing smoke up all of his fighters' asses, and they truly believe that they're kings, and they deserve all of this, that they're the biggest draws of the sport. Your thoughts on Spence's commentary last night when he was in the crowd at the Alamo Dome?
Fuck him. He acts like he's some superstar prima donna. He's not, okay? Fuck him. Look, Mike Tyson, 55-year-old Mike Tyson draws better than him in pay-per-view, okay? But his last pay-per-view, they said it was over 200. Bullshit. It was like 125, like you were telling me, okay? He's not as, you know, big. He ain't no mainstream star. He acts like he's some fucking prima donna. And this is a fight people have been wanting to see for years, him and Crawford. And like I tell people all the time, back in the days, you know, the best fight the best, and they did whatever it took to get the fight done. Now all they do is talk and make excuses. That's all they do, these motherfuckers. That's why I lost a lot of respect for a lot of these fighters. I don't respect too many fighters in boxing nowadays, yo. These young kids, they talk too much. They got no balls. They'll quit when the fight gets tough, okay? And you see a lot of that happening now, okay? You know, once the fight gets a little tough, you know, they're ready to throw the towel in instead of, gritting down and having that mental intestinal fortitude to fight through these through the adversity in a tough fight. But the thing is, like I said, Spence, it made him look real, real bad when he started acting like, Mrs. Queen Prima Donna. And I'm the king, I'm the top dog, and I should get this. And, fuck you. That's what I think about you. You know what I mean? Fuck you. Who cares about you, man? I don't give a shit. I'll never pay for none of his pay-per-views. Hell no. I'll pirate it for free, or I watch it here in Mexico, on ESPN Knockouts for free. But I'm not sure. To me, he ain't no pay-per-view fighter. You know what I mean? None of these motherfuckers now are worth pay-per-view. Only one is Canelo, and Canelo's got to be in a big fight. Now, you look at Canelo. You put him in a fight, a pay-per-view fight, he'll probably do, 300 against a guy like Liam Smith? But then that was in the good times, okay? That was before the pandemic and the economy went to shit. Now, you come back and bring him on a pay-per-view. How do you think he'll do? What do you think he'll draw? Nothing like Mike Tyson. Mike Tyson is still the biggest draw in boxing, okay? All right? 1.5, 1.6 million, him and Roy Jones. He's still the big dog in boxing. Now, it ain't Canelo. It ain't that bitch Earl Spence or any of them PBC fighters that think they're stars, okay? It's Mike Tyson. He's still the man in boxing, believe it or not. But anyway, like I said, he really when he started saying that, I'm like, who the fuck is he? You know what I mean?
Well,
he's a good fighter, and I like Earl. As a fighter, he's a good fighter.
He's an excellent fighter, but he's an excellent fighter, but
Just in case, amateurs, I know him since the amateurs because he used to.
I had a top
amateur back in the days. He was a top amateur back in the days, and one of my guys I had back then was a top amateur. They used to be on the same team and all that crap. So, but I never got to know him, and I just stayed my distance and everything. But anyway, like I said, I knew he would be a top pro. I don't know when we did our show back in the days. Back in 2012, I was telling you he was the best prospect on USA Boxing, professional prospect.
Mm-hmm.
Remember that, Joe, back in the days, our show?
I do. I remember.
I said he was the top prospect. Yeah,
and
that was obvious. But the thing is, like I said, his success now, like I said, is, to me, the reason why he's big in Dallas is because of Jerry Jones and the Dallas Cowboys. Getting behind them, using their marketing department to sell tickets to their season ticket holders, okay? I know this for a fact because I know the guy that runs, that helps the event coordinator, Lester Bedford, who got him hooked up with Jerry Jones, even Stephen Jones, Jerry Jones' son, got him hooked up with him and started bringing fights back to Dallas because of Lester, started getting, once Jerry Jones got involved, the Dallas Cowboys got involved. And that's why, the marketing department started selling all the tickets to their season tickets, season ticket holders. Oh, yeah, that was, and he thinks it was him. Uh-uh. It was them guys, all right? It was them guys that, made him the draw. And his pay-per-view sucked. Like I said, you could combine him, Fatboy Tank Davis, the Charlo brothers, Tyson Fury, Wilder, combine that all together, and it still didn't beat Mike Tyson. Isn't that fucking sad, Joe?
Well, what's the most sad, Gogi, is these guys walk around like they're superstars, beating their chests, making just ridiculous demands. Now, listen to this. Just in case you missed that part of DAZN, everybody, I'm going to read Errol Spence's quote when Chris Mannix asked him about Terrence Crawford fight. I'm the big dog in the welterweight division. Crawford has to take a back seat and take that 60-40 or maybe 70-30, whatever we decide to give him. Like I said, I can go up to 160 and fight Canelo Alvarez if I want to. I don't need him. End quote.
Canelo
Gogi,
don't need him. Canelo don't need that little that wannabe drama queen. Okay, that wannabe prima donna. Canelo don't need him.
Exactly. And that was my point. I'm like, you know what? First of all, we have Wilder on these delusional rants thinking that he's an unbeatable fighter and one of the greatest heavyweights of all time. And when he gets smashed by Tyson Fury, he becomes delusional and he's like looking for every excuse in the book. He can't deal with it. Then you've got the Charlo brothers thinking that they're the next big superstars of boxing. Oh, we're pay-per-view stars now. Well, you didn't even sell 70,000. And now you've got this. Gogi, there has to come to a point in time where Heyman has to start giving his clients the reality of their market value.
Okay, this is becoming
exactly, that's my point. He needs to stop blowing smoke up their ass because they're all becoming delusional drama queens, delusional prima donnas, and it's bad for the health of the sport, Gogi.
Well,
I mean, my goodness, man.
They're finding out reality real quick, what their market value is, okay? They're not superstar, you know, fighters that could put big pay-per-view numbers up or put massive assets in the seats, okay? They're finding out real quick and everything. And guess what? These networks or Showtime or Fox, who's ever doing the pay-per-view behind it, if they're not making money, especially if they're losing money, they're going to cut that shit out real fast. Them pay-per-views are going to come to a screeching halt.
Yeah, well, no, Well, that's for another show. We'll talk about that sometime later down the road. But I'll say this, Gogi. Crawford was watching. He heard the interview, and he immediately tweeted this, quote, "And they said it was me." He tweeted it with a shrugging emoji, right? And he just went on to say, "I rest my case now. On to the next. The Errol Spence chapter is now closed," end quote. So it doesn't look like fight fans are going to get the only fight in the welterweight division that we are willing to pay for. Spence versus Crawford doesn't sound like it's going to happen. I mean,
even if they fight, I wouldn't pay for that. Shit. You know, I still watch it. Like I said, I get it for free over here in ESPN Knockouts, okay? But, you know, everybody's doing illegal pirating nowadays, so you know what I mean?
Well, and if you look at DAZN and we're listening to Eddie Hearn in the post-fight press conference, according to DAZN, and obviously he didn't disclose numbers, but according to subscription purchases last night, DAZN is very happy with how everything turned out, according to Eddie Hearn. They were happy with the production. They were happy with Canelo's performance. And most importantly, they were happy with the subscription performance, the purchase performance. So it's a win-win for the industry. That was last night, Gogi. I can't stress enough how huge that fight was for the health of the sport. The future of boxing is obviously going to be on either the way Arum is doing it on free TV or with the ESPN Plus app or the DAZN app. The smart buy would have been to purchase the $19.99 monthly buy when the Joshua fight came on, so you already got that 30-day allotment for $19.99, and you were able to see both Golovkin and Canelo the following weekend for free with your $19.99 purchase, right? That was the smart buy, and we encouraged everyone to do that last week. And that seems to be the future of boxing, Gogi. Why on earth is anyone still offering outrageous prices with the cable and satellite distributors?
Because they're fucking greedy. You know, they got that Mayweather mentality. I'm going to suck every dollar out of the consumer out there. Because of the success of Mayweather, they're like, oh, my God, look at all the money Floyd made. But they're not Floyd. They're not pay-per-view stars, okay? That's what they got, that mentality. Al's the one that put that shit in their head. I'm going to make you guys pay-per-view stars. It's Al, okay? It's Al that's the poison, okay? That's putting that shit in their head. They're not pay-per-view stars. They're far from pay-per-view, and they'll never be pay-per-view stars, okay? Because of the success of Floyd, they think they could copy what Floyd did and have the same success. And nobody gives a shit about them guys, man. I mean, Joe, the numbers don't lie, how many they sell, okay? And like I said, you combine all those guys that fought on pay-per-view for PBC, and Mike Tyson still beat them by a good 50%.
Yeah, and so now you look forward, and, you know, 2021, listening to Eddie Hearn, boy, he's got a couple of great matchups on the horizon. Now, obviously, on January 2nd, we're already going to see Ryan Garcia versus Luke Campbell on DAZN, with a potential winner facing Devin Haney for the WBC lightweight title later on in the year. He's also managed or promoted by Eddie Hearn as well. And it was announced last night that in March, we're going to see a unification bout in the super flyweight division between Chocla Tito and Gallo Estrada. That is a great fight.
Yeah.
And then they're talking about in May, Cinco de Mayo weekend, Canelo Alvarez versus BJ Saunders. Again, to try in a unification bout in the super middleweight division, with Golovkin possibly fighting Canelo in a huge trilogy fight. And then there, he also mentioned, he goes, and don't forget, guys, right now, we're currently working on Tyson Fury versus Anthony Joshua for a June date. So I tell you what, right now, yeah, things are looking up for DAZN. A lot of people were actually calling them, oh, they're going to back out of the sport. And their future did seem to be in doubt as far as their commitment in North America. But it looks like they're all in once again. Thank you, Eddie Hearn.
We'll see, Joe.
Thank
you. We'll see, okay, because let's see if they got out of that financial crisis there. You know, they were experiencing, okay? Let's see if they could, you know, bounce back.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what kind of agreement Top Rank and Matchroom Sport come up with, and Queensbury, Frank Warren, see what they come up with in terms of distribution for Tyson Fury versus Anthony Joshua. What network is that going to be on? How much is it going to be? Where is it going to be? I mean, Eddie Hearn is like, look, unless we get things under control in the pandemic, you can almost guarantee in order to pay for this fight, in order to get the money that both fighters are going to require
live
for Fury versus Joshua, you're going to have to either put it in front of a huge live gate, but if the pandemic is still uncertain, they're talking about put it in the Middle East, just like they did Joshua versus Andy Ruiz Jr. too. Yep. So, so that's what they're working on right now. But I tell you what, Gogi, it's exciting to think of all these fights taking place. And, I'm really excited for 2021 already. But congratulations to Canelo Alvarez. Boy, he put on a fine Hall of Fame-type performance, pound-for-pound-type performance. Gogi, in your mind, is he the best pound-for-pound fighter in boxing right now?
You know, Joe, before the fight, I was saying to myself, if he beats this guy who's a solid fighter, okay, and a solid champion, Callum Smith, and he beats him dominantly, he's going to elevate himself to the number one pound-for-pound fighter in boxing. Yes, he is. I had Crawford number one, but because of that performance, that dominating performance last night, I have Canelo right now, number one pound-for-pound fighter in the world.
Yeah, I would have to agree with you, and I don't see anyone disagreeing with you at this time, Gogi. That was very impressive. You know, and we talk about future Hall of Famer. Yeah, if he retired today, he would be a first ballot Hall of Famer. So that segues now, and again, this was announced last week, but we haven't had a chance to talk to you about this because of this big event. But in the final minutes of the show, let's talk about the International Boxing Hall of Fame in Canastota, their 2021 inductees. I want to get your thoughts on this, especially the snubs. So the fighters, the modern fighters who were inducted this year, who's going to be inducted next year, right? Floyd Mayweather Jr., Andre Ward, and Vladimir Klitschko are going to be inducted into the International Boxing Hall of Fame in Canastota. Now, the three fighters who were snubbed, shockingly, James Toney, Miguel Cotto, and Tim Bradley. I can see Tim Bradley not being a first ballot Hall of Famer, but James Toney and Miguel Cotto, Gogi?
Especially James Toney. Give me a fucking break. What happens, you know,
Jeez.
Because of this because of this fucking political correct environment. They're allowing women in there, and you know, Layla Ali and Ann Wolf took their places.
Yep.
Now you come on, man. You're gonna tell me, man, Layla Ali couldn't carry James Toney's jockstrap? Okay. All right. Plain and simple. She has no business being in there before James Toney. James Toney was a true first ballot Hall of Famer, okay? But, you know, that's just, Joe, it's politics, okay? It's politics, and they, you know, the people that have voted, you know, they were probably instructed to say, hey, you got to pick two women and everything, you know? Because, look, you know, they're, you know, they want women in boxing to be accepted, you know, which I really, you know, nothing against them, but there's only a couple women fighters I follow. The rest I could care less about. You know what I mean? And, you know, they wanted a couple women fighters, and they got Layla, you know, Layla, she did all right. You know, she did good. I mean, I never, you know, I watched a few of her fights, and
she was
I really liked
Ann. For the sport. She was.
Well, you know, I like it. Christy Martin's the one that started women's boxing before Layla, okay?
Agreed.
She's the one that got it
Agreed.
Hot in the 90s.
Agreed.
Okay?
Mm-hmm.
And, but, you know, that's why, then, you know, just to, you know, pick, because of this, you know, this equal rights bullshit out there, you know what I mean? To snub him, you know, that's totally disrespectful sport. You know what I mean? Come on, man. Like I said, Layla Ali couldn't carry James Toney's jockstrap, okay? All right? She fought off her dad's name and everything. But like I said, it's she's a tenth of a fighter what Toney was in skills, mentality.
Yeah.
Okay?
Oh.
Come on, man. Give me a fucking break. But anyway, man, you know, this is a different era of boxing we're in. We're in this politically correct and, you know, bullshit politically structured environment we're in, you know, and boxing is fucking a bunch of horse shit. That's what it is.
Yeah, I was in shock, Gogi. And then when you consider that Sylvester Stallone is in the International Boxing Hall of Fame for the, well, for his mythical Rocky character and everything he's done for the sport to promote boxing, and James Toney and Miguel Cotto were left out. Wow. It's shocking.
Yeah.
Now, that, it's a guarantee that they're going to eventually be inducted, but come on now. Those guys are first ballot Hall of Famers.
Yeah.
Like Miguel Cotto was a superstar and Puerto Rico's only four-division world champion. James Toney is an absolute legend, and you could stick him in any era, and he would have done well. He's an all-time great, man.
Oh, yeah.
It's shocking. Here's another one that you might find shocking. In the non-participant section, Freddie Brown, Jackie McCoy, and Dr. Margaret Goodman are being inducted in 2021, but they overlooked matchmaker Brad Goodman and the CEO of WBO, Paco Varcasel. They overlooked both of those.
Brad will get in eventually. Brad is a Hall of Fame matchmaker, you know. He's one of the best. I mean, you know, like he was, you know, like I said, he was taught by his mentor, Bruce Trampler, on how to develop fighters, you know, when they're coming up from scratch, picking the right opponents. For each fighter, you know, coming up and everything. Brad, he'll get there. He'll be a Hall of Famer, you know, one day. And Jackie McCoy deserved to be. You know, a lot of people don't know who Jackie McCoy is. He was, you know, he worked closely with Don Chargan back in the days when Don was at Olympic. He took all his fighters from scratch. He had like five world champions and everything. And Jackie, like I said, Don told me, Jackie McCoy was a trainer manager out of L.A. He had Carlos Palomino, Raul Rojas, Mongo Ramos, and you know Don Jordan, and a couple one or two other world champions. Don Chargan told me he always took guys from scratch and built them up all the way to you know the champions with Don's help you know promoting and matchmaking along with Miss Eileen Eaton. Don told me, out of all the champions he had at the Olympic, Jackie McCoy was the only one that had more than one. He said the other trainers that had champions with Don, he goes, they were one-hit wonders. He goes, they would get lucky if they had other. He said they would get they would get. He said they would get lucky if they had fighters in the preliminary fights. You know, it was more Don's matchmaking and the fighter's talent that made him champion, rather than the, you know, the coach himself. Because if you're any kind of a type of good coach, Joe, you should produce, you know, fighters, you know, one after the other. You know what I mean? Especially if you got a damn great matchmaker like Don Jardine. You know what I mean? You should, you know, if you got the talent and with a matchmaker like Don Jardine, you should be able to develop more champions. And Jackie, yeah, Jackie was, what do you call it? Old school guy. He passed away, 15 years ago. I met him a few times, you know, when he was in, when I was up at Sacramento as a young kid. He, you know, he had a, you know, when Don was promoting shows, Don, you know, would let a few of his fighters, and he come, you know, the week of the fight, they would train in our gym. And, you know, never got to know him that good, you know, because he passed away. But everybody was telling me he was a hell of a trainer, you know, a very knowledgeable trainer. And, I was shocked that they actually picked him and everything. And people know who, a lot of people don't know who he is.
Yeah, well, congratulations for all the inductees for the International Boxing Hall of Fame in 2021. But, yeah, Gogi, I was a bit surprised that Miguel Cotto and James Toney were snubbed. I kind of figured Tim Bradley would have to wait, but I'm sorry, go ahead.
McGill, he should be in there, but
he was a legitimate superstar. And Puerto Rico's only four-division world champion. But, yeah, look forward to next year, I guess. But before we let everyone go, Gogi, now when talking about the prospect of fighting Billy Joe Saunders, right, Eddie Hearn thought about, well, we want to increase, if Canelo is indeed interested, and I think he is, in working with us in the future, expanding his global brand, why not? As long as there's no pandemic, why not put Canelo and BJ Saunders in Wembley Stadium? Would that be a smart move?
That'd be a good idea if the money's right. Canelo's all about getting the best money possible, man. That's what he likes about being a free agent. He ain't got to be, you know, he ain't married to none of these guys. He could go where the best deal is possible. You know, if Al and Stevie Espinosa offer more money, or Fox, hey, man, he'll go over there. But, yeah, if Eddie comes up with the money, I think that would be a great way to expand his base, to go to England. Because I think that would be a huge fight over there in England, okay, with Canelo and B.J. Saunders.
Now, B.J. Saunders, he fought Martin Murray in his last fight, and poor Martin Murray, that guy's such a workhorse, but he's obviously not the same fighter that he once was. He's 38 now. BJ Saunders put on a boxing clinic. He looked great. How do you see that style matchup? Is that a difficult style matchup for Canelo Alvarez, this 168-pound version of Canelo Alvarez?
Well, Canelo's strong as a bull, man. Saunders is the one that's going to have the problems. Okay, if you can't keep him off him, Canelo's evidently, you know, eventually he's going to walk him down and get that distance where he wants, and he's going to brutalize him just like he did, Liam Smith and Callum Smith. But you know, he's a very athletic fighter. You know, a very sharp, quick counter puncher, good movement, and you know, it's going to be, it's a very tough stylistic matchup, okay? This guy has better legs on him than, Callum Smith, okay?
Callum.
He's real tricky, real clever. And he's a southpaw, okay? So, it'll be a more difficult style. But, you know, Canelo, you know, he's in his prime, Joe. He's fighting the best of his career, okay? All around, offensively, defensively, everything. You know, he's a complete fighter. And just catching this jackrabbit, cornering him, on the ropes or in the corners, not letting him move, then it's over with. But anyway, Saunders is the one that's going to have the problems. He's going to have more of the problems, especially when Canelo starts landing them big bombs on him. But, the style, a tricky southpaw that moves, it's going to be very difficult. It's difficult to fight. But Canelo, he's at the point of his career. He could adapt to any style. He's fought them all. He knows how to cut the ring off. He knows how to apply intelligent pressure. And when he gets there, he knows the combinations that are going to work on the specific opponent he's going to work on. I know Canelo, he'll probably be targeting that midsection, that straight right hand of the body, you know, to slow him down a little. You know what I mean? Or, you know, when he gets inside, of course, some brutal uppercuts, the hooks, and everything. You know what I mean? But Canelo, he wants to pin you. He wants to make you a stationary target, putting you on the ropes or in the corners.
Yeah, I tell you what, I love the style matchup against this version of Canelo Alvarez. You know, before I thought it was the most difficult style matchup at 168 minus David Benavidez. But after watching Canelo effectively cut off the ring and close the distance and being able to slip in and out of range to avoid incoming, I was really impressed. And now, I think Canelo bashes him, beats him up, and stops him within the distance. Because, you know, regardless of what you guys may think about Callum Smith, boy, that guy's got an iron chin, and he's a very tough, tough kid. Right,
he's a good.
BJ Saunders,
he's a solid
that
world
kind
champion.
Of beard.
Canelo destroyed. Canelo manhandled him, dominated him. Okay.
Yep. I tell you what. Now I would be remiss if I didn't mention this before we left, Gogi. Did you see Golovkin fight Zarameta on Friday night on DAZN? Did you see that?
Like I thought. Like I said, Joe, it was a mismatch. Going in, I knew it was a mismatch. And,
That's not what I want to talk about, though, Gogi.
Yeah.
Did you take a look at Golovkin's physique?
Oh, shit. Well, I question everybody nowadays if they don't do drug testing. Okay, Joe, leave it like that.
Mm-hmm.
If there's no drug testing, I question. And if there's no drug testing, if they're older and there's no drug testing and they put on performances like they're, when they're like they're 30 years old, come on, man. All right. I question it. And that's Canelo, too.
Well, I tell you what, Matchroom Sport, DAZN.
Until they do drug testing, then, you know, some good, effective drug testing, then, and they come up clean, then I'll believe their performances. But nowadays, everybody's a suspect in that damn boxing ring, man, if they don't do no drug testing.
Golovkin, now, once again, Kamil Zarameta's no world beater, right? He is the number 23 ranked fighter in the world, and you didn't even want to talk about this matchup last week because you could see that it was going to be completely one-sided. Yep, it would be a mismatch.
Yeah.
With that said, though, boy, Golovkin looked razor sharp. He looked strong. He looked well-rested. I think the 14 months off really did him a world of good, and he was definitely in the gym. Oof, geez, he looked huge. How is he that big, that strong, at 38 years old, continuously making 160, Gogi?
You know what? Golovkin is, what do you call it? He's an old-school throwback fighter that, you know, keeps himself in shape year-round. And he's a worker. He's a very, very hard, diligent worker when he gets ready for a fight. Okay? So, you have that kind of discipline like Bernard Hopkins. You know, you can make the weight all the time, you know. Strict diet and strict training between fights, you know, staying in shape. You know, to me, that's the key. You know, Golovkin, you can see that he keeps his body in shape between fights. He just doesn't do nothing, okay? And his work ethic in the gym, from what I've seen on video, he's a worker. You know, he's a very, very hard, diligent worker in the gym.
Indeed, and it shows in the ring. But Gogi, that seems to be about it. Now, once again, Canelo. I think, after this event, as long as the money's there, like you stated, I can't see him fighting. I can see him staying with Matchroom Sport and DAZN through 2021 for those two big fights, possibly one in England, and then the big one, the trilogy fight back in the States, in September for Mexican Independence Day, right? I can see that happening. And again, Golovkin by that time is going to be 39 years old. How do you see this matchup playing out against a prime Canelo Alvarez and a 39-year-old Gennady Golovkin?
He's older now, Joe. But, Joe, I don't know. He looked 30 the other night, so... If he keeps doing what he's doing, hey, yo. But that matchup will always be tough because Golovkin's got a dominating jab, okay? All right? Mm-hmm. As long as you got something to deter Canelo. You can see Canelo when he fought Golovkin. He didn't just walk straight in, okay? Mm-hmm. The second fight he did, but he got hit with a lot of punches. He still got his attention, okay? He still got his attention,
yep.
But Canelo's, like I said, he's at the peak of his career. He's 30 years old, okay? He's not going to be 40. And he's evolved to a better all-around fighter. You know, I don't think it's going to be competitive like the first two. I think Canelo will beat him more dominant this time around. Not bad as, Callum Smith. But it'll be a more clear-cut decision. Because the first time they fight, I thought Golovkin won. I was surprised he gave it a draw. The second fight, it could have been a draw or go either way, okay? But the third fight, without a doubt, you know, Canelo's going to lead that, you know, without a doubt. I won this fight and everything. But, you know, this fight should have happened a long fucking time ago. That's why it pisses me off about Canelo. That's what one thing will always stain, will tick me about him. When he had the chance to fight Golovkin in his prime, that's when super fights are super fights, when both fighters are in their prime. He decided not to fight him, give up his belt, and wait for Golovkin to age 2 years, okay?
Yep.
2 fucking years before they finally fought. And when they fought, I thought Golovkin won by 1 or 2 points, okay? And then in the rematch, he made him wait longer, okay, to get more older, and it was a draw, which I thought it was a draw, but they gave him the decision because of, you know, Ali Bird. Then the third fight, he waited for Golovkin to wait, you know, to, you know, the
39 even, he's
you know,
gonna
to
be.
Age even more. So, yeah. And super fights are when the fighters are in their prime, not their fucking past prime. And that's why, you know, that's one thing that will always irk me about Canelo. You know what I mean? What he did about Golovkin and how he just gave up his belt. Old-time greats never gave up their belts, okay? Not like Canelo did. But he's a hell of a fighter.
Yeah, absolutely.
I ain't taking nothing away from him. He's a hell of a fighter.
He's currently the best fighter in boxing, in my opinion, but yeah. He's a bully and a diva.
Yeah. Well, he has a right to be a diva.
In real life.
Joe, he has a right to be a diva. You know, he moves a needle. Okay, look.
That is true.
I know people that were trying to order that DAZN thing, but the server was down because too many people were trying to get in the order. Okay, it broke down.
Wow.
To me, that's the guy that moves a needle. He puts asses in the seats. Okay. You know what I mean? He's well known. You know what I mean? He's not mainstream, not in America, because he don't speak the language. You know, Manny Pacquiao was mainstream. Floyd Mayweather was mainstream. Canelo's not mainstream in the United States. Hell no. He don't speak the language. You got to speak English. Okay, you got to go on the talk shows like Manny Pacquiao. You got to sing songs out there. You know, like Manny Pacquiao. Manny Pacquiao was an international superstar. Okay, Canelo ain't on that level yet. You know what I mean? But he's a hell of a fighter, Joe. Yeah, he's a hell of a fighter, but it's just some little things that really peeved me about him, what he did, you know what I mean, coming up. Then he got caught with juice, you know what I mean, and, you know, like all of them deny it, you know, and all that shit and all that stuff.
Yeah,
you know, I'm not taking nothing away from his skills and his fighting ability. He's a hell of a fighter.
Okay, so the final part of analysis I'm going to ask you before we leave, Gogi. In the event that he does go for the big money rather than unifying the 168-pound weight division with Billy Joe Saunders, because you can't argue, presented with the option of fighting Errol Spence Jr. on Cinco de Mayo on PBC, Fox pay-per-view, that's obviously would be the bigger money matchup, right?
He can't make 160, okay?
I don't think so either. That's the primary reason why, I think.
We're talking about fantasy land, okay? That fight ain't going to happen because he ain't going to want to. He's a star. Why should he have to drop down to fight this motherfucker that ain't that ain't on his level. That ain't, you know what I mean? That doesn't have the marketability that Canelo has. You know what I mean? It ain't going to happen.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Indeed. Yeah, I think it's terrible for Errol Spence as well. And honestly, once again, it's just Heyman trying to pitch Canelo with a potential big money matchup to try and get him to compete for PBC. That's it.
Yeah,
that's all it is.
160, come on, man. I mean, they better offer Canelo. I mean, then Canelo's got to make the sacrifices and move down in weight, man. You know what I mean? Canelo don't need him, okay? Earl needs Canelo. Canelo don't need it. That wannabe prima donna, okay? Canelo's a star right now. And, you know, his star got brighter yesterday after that great performance. And he calls the shots. He, you know, he could tell Al, yeah, fuck you. You want to come fight me? Come fight me at 168 for one of my belts, okay? You know what I mean? That's what he, because he's a, and Earl Spence ain't the, if they fought in Dallas, it would be, and the place was packed, it would be because of Canelo, okay? Not fucking Earl Spence. Just like when he fought Mikey Garcia. All the Hispanics, the Mexicans went out there to support Mikey Garcia, not Earl Spence, okay?
And there you have it, brother. So that's going to conclude. And, guys, look at Fight Saga tomorrow, because Gogi's rant on the potential matchups for Canelo Alvarez in 2021, it's going to be on the internet in fightsaga.com form. So look for that article by me tomorrow, guys, based on the interview that you just heard on this show. But I tell you what, Gogi, that's going to just about do it. Do you have any parting shots for our listening audience?
No, that was a big shot in the arm for boxing last night. Joe, I was really shocked by the presentation Matchroom did. You know, I bash Eddie a lot. You know, I've been saying that he's been doing a shit job of promoting fights lately in the States, and he has.
Yep.
But he finally got one right. He finally got one right. They had a good crowd there that, you know, you could feel the energy watching it, okay? The presentation, the ring walk, the fireworks, just, you know, everything. And the fight was, you know, of course, Canelo looked the best of his career and everything. So it was a good shot in the arm for boxing. And hopefully we could take this fight and build something on it next year. And the powers be don't fuck shit up by avoiding the best matchups out there, okay? Spence Crawford should be happening. But that ain't going to happen. You know, you heard that last night because that bitch, that fucking bitch Spence, you know what I mean? Mr. Prima Donna. And that's what boxing needs. It needs great fights. It needs great, great, great events, especially not only at the venue it's at, but over national TV so the people can see it and get excited about it like they do UFC. See, boxing right now, man, it's a niche sport. Nobody gives a shit about it. The sentiment level's real low, okay? And it's got to change. And last night was a good shot in the arm, and Canelo, you know, he provided that boost. And hopefully, the next fight he does, it keeps on injecting more energy in the sport, and the sentiment level goes up, you know, in boxing where, you know, the great fans are out there supporting us like in the past. But one last
guys,
thing, Joe.
He's, Joe. Go ahead, sir. Yes, sir.
One last thing.
Go ahead,
Yeah, one
sir.
Last thing. Fuck you, Earl Spence. You're a little bitch, all right? He's a bitch. Fuck him.
Guys, he's James Gogi, 5-decade fight trainer. Gogi, thank you so much for always a memorable show, brother, but this one was great. Guys, in case you missed any part of it, it's going to be on the YouTube platform on our War Week Radio Network page on YouTube. Be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. That's going to just about do it, guys. On behalf of James Gogi, I'm Joseph Herron. You've been listening to War Week Radio. Have a great evening, everybody.